everybody. What's up? All right, here we are inside the packet tracer with yours truly, Laz. We're going to create a lab, but we're going to create a lab in different parts. All right, it's going to be a big lab that's going to consist of everything that you would need for your CCNA for the most part. I may have to switch simulators to show you something else like MPLS and stuff like that, but for the most part, we'll be working here in the Cisco packet tracer. All right. And we'll do the very first part. The very first episode is today. Okay, the very first episode is right now. And we're gonna do it from scratch so you can see how I do it. Alright, so we can create it. Alright. And as we evolve into the rest of the stuff, the lab will continue to grow. Okay? So stick with me, alright? Pay attention. Try to recreate, pause, take notes, copy, do what I do. It's from scratch now. It's from scratch, so there's no excuse, you can do it. All right, so what I'm gonna do, we get the packet tracer open. The first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna do some switches, right? So in the CCNA, all you got is layer two switches. So I'm gonna go in here, it's a layer two, switch. I'm gonna get 2960, I'll put it up here. That's one, that's two, that's three. Eventually, there's going to be a backbone running down through here. And then I'm going to get PCs. I'm going to get one PC. All right, we'll put it up here. I'm going to get another PC. And then I'm going to get a server. All right, because we want to do different things with it. All right, because with a packet tracer, if you open it up and look at services, I don't know if you ever have, but open it up. Because you got radius, you got news time, you can do email, TFTP, you can do DHCP. You can change this. Look, let's change this. All right, let's change it where it says Cisco Packet Tracer. I'm gonna change that right there. I'm gonna say Lazaro Laz in parentheses Diaz. All right, I'm gonna save that. There's a radio file with that same name. Do you wanna overwrite it? Yes, I do. Wanna overwrite it? And since this is a server, let's bring this down here so you can see it fully. Okay. I'm going to give it an IP address, all right? Even though we haven't set an IP scheme yet, so we'll do that in a little bit. All right, so we got the three switches, but we need a core switch. Still gonna be a layer two switch. Why? Because that's what you need to learn how to work with for the CCNA. All of you out there that are already working for IT departments and are using layer three switches and you're doing all this advanced networking, do not let that, but you have no certification. I'm not saying you don't know your stuff. I'm saying you're just not certified. You never had the need to, and now you need to get it. Now you're going to be like, oh, well, we don't do that like that in the real world. Yeah, you don't, okay? But you do for the certification. So for the certification, this is what you need to do, and your mindset needs to be focused on passing the CCNA. I'm not yelling. I'm not upset. Speaking loudly and clearly so you can understand me, okay? You need to pay attention to what I'm telling you. So take the real world out of here. Now that doesn't mean that what we're gonna do, you don't do in the real world. Might do it slightly different, okay? Especially from layer two to layer three switches, but again, CCNA. All right, so let me take another switch, another 2960. This will be our core switch, yeah. And then, we're gonna have a router. Now, lately I've been using 2911 routers, okay? 2911 or 2901, just for the simple fact that this is the only one that has the license in there. So when we do the license lab, I can actually show you, you know, how you would enable a technology package, okay? So now we're gonna connect it. So we need to know the type of cables. Now you can cheat, you can just use the lightning bolt. But it's straight through from PC, all right, to the switch is a straight through. Now, me, Lazaro J. Diaz, when I'm connecting my host to my switch, I use low ports. Like, it's always going to be F01, guaranteed. Okay, put it up there on my server, it's going to be the same thing, F01. Now, when I go from the switches, I go connected to my core switch. I'm going to, it's a crossover cable, right? Similar devices. So I'm going to click on port 24, and then here I'll click on port 1. Why do I do that? Why does he do that? So if I do CDP on this switch right here, or LDP, even though it doesn't tell me the IP address, that's why I don't like LDP, tells me the chassis ID. When I do CDP neighbor detail, then I'm trying to match up the IP address, I go, you're looking at it, it shows me, oh, it shows me the port, M024. Like, oh, well, that's the switch below me. And I'm on F01. So it's easy. It's a visualization thing, not a requirement that was made by Cisco. Okay? It's a visualization thing. So let's go ahead and do the same thing. All right. And then we'll do here port 24 again. We'll pick port 2. See how I make things easy? All right? And here to remember, oh, which port did you plug it into? Was it port 80, port, 91, some weird number like that? Oops, I put 4, see, for talking. Shouldn't be talking, it should just be plugging this stuff in. Okay, here, port 24 again. And then go to port 3. All right, and then when I go from the core switch to the router, which is a straight through, okay, I pick 24, yeah, 24, so when I do CDP there, I can see, hey, this is going to the router, because I know, and it's a gigabit, all right, it's a gigabit port. Now, these are here, we're going to create our IP addressing scheme right now, it's going to be very simple. All right, let me bring this a little bit more towards the middle, so you can see it a little bit better, all right. Our IP addressing scheme will be simple, we're not going to do nothing crazy, all right. This is switch 1, switch 2, and we'll leave it like that. I just like the whole name, leave it like that. So let's just call it SW1. Right, and I just click on the host name, SW2, right, and SW3. Very simple, very easy to do. Okay, very simple, very easy to do. Now I'm gonna go ahead and create a label, if I can find the label. Looks like a razor blade, at least to me anyway. 192.168.100.0. And this will be VLAN. Oh, let's do this. Make it even easier. 10.0. And that's a CIDR 24. And that's going to be VLAN 10. Oh, look at that. IP address 10, VLAN 10. So that's going to be very easy to do. All right. Okay. Let's go ahead and click on. Let's make another label. So 192.168.20.0/24. So what do you think the VLAN is going to be? VLAN 20. Yup, that's exactly right. Let me get my pointer back. I'm tired of typing already. I'll just click up. All right, and then we're going to do Control C, Control V. All right, and then we'll click inside there, change that to 30. All right, so we got our 3 VLANs here. Now we know what to put on the server. I, use the first available IP address for the host and the last available IP address for my default gateway, which is my router, not my switch, my router, okay? So I go to IP services, all right, 192.168. Where am I? I'm in the server, that's 30.1. Tab. 192.168.30.254, and I am going to be my own DNS server. We'll just put ourselves as our own DNS server. 31. Okay, so we can go ahead and then use the browser name resolution, whatever. But let's take a look at the one that we typed in there. Type my own IP address 192.168.30.1. We got LazRoLaz Diaz, right? But we want to make sure DNS is set up. We can resolve that using DNS. All right, well right now we have our devices, our internet networking devices, router, switch, all right, we know which VLANs we're gonna go into, but as well, all right, in a real world scenario, okay, everybody gets DHCP, and that's not true, because I have worked for certain companies that they're, every floor has at least like 300 people or so. Let's say between 100, 200, 300 people per floor. And everything is assigned statically. But guess who assigns the IP address? Not the IT guy. an email is actually sent to the end user to show them how to put in their new IP address or whatever the case may be, and they're the ones that do it. Yeah, no, bad practice. Your end users do not need to be getting into your networking environment, your command prompt, and all sorts of things like that, all right? So, no, we will be configuring DHCP on this router right here for these three particular VLANs. All right, so let's go to the core switch. Now, one thing I said, eventually you will see lines coming down here, but for the sake, because I'm going to turn this into the root bridge, which is spanning tree. All right, so I'm not going to get too deep into spanning tree right now, but I need real redundancy. As you can see here, there's no redundancy. Spanning tree is working regardless, but it's not really there. It's not blocking any ports. It's no root ports or anything like that. So what we're going to do is I'm going to get, let's say, port 20 to port 20, and then port 21 to port 21. Okay, same port. Yes, consistency, memory, getting old, guys, getting old. I gotta make sure that I remember things, okay? So that's why I pick the ports that I do and do the things that I do, okay? All right, so now really, I'm gonna fast forward through time, and this is a lifesaver, this freaking button right here. And sometimes the packet tracer is working so slow that it takes forever for anything to take effect, okay? So now, we need to see who's the bridge. Well, obviously it's not this guy, because these ports are blocked right here, okay? And block doesn't mean that it's not listening or getting information. It's just not forwarding anything out of its ports. Not sending anything out of the ports. Okay? But do we have any switch that everything is green going towards it? Yeah, look. Green going this way. Green coming this way. And green going that way. So this has to be the root bridge. Just on the lights. Not in the real world, you have real lights. You know, in the test, you're not going to have real lights. Outside the recording area and say, hey, what's this? Enable show spanning tree, and lo and behold, it is the root bridge. Okay, and I picked it because of the lowest MAC address. But we're gonna make this guy the root bridge. All right, one instance of spanning tree across all VLANs. I say again, one instance of spanning tree across all VLANs. Therefore, come in here. All right, let's open this guy up. This core switch. All right, I'm gonna do enable config t host name core. All right, and then we're gonna do spanning tree VLAN 1, 10, 20, 30 priority. Now, I'm going to type a number there and make a mistake on purpose. I'm going to type in, because the lower the priority number makes you the root bridge. Right? The default is 32.769. But, so anything lower than that, you know, you figure, hey man, anything lower than that, I'll be root bridge. Yeah, well, guess what? All right, let's put 1,000 or 100, whatever. It's going to say, no, you can't do that. It's got to be from 0 and then in increments of 4096. That's the allowed value. So I'll put 0, I'm gonna up arrow. So I'm gonna put back that command, and I'm gonna backspace that 100 and put 0. So then everything starts going crazy. Do WR, you cannot do WR in your exam. You gotta go back to privilege mode, do copy and start. Everything starts going nuts, right? Ports start changing. You see these are now green. Okay, this is green, that's green, that's green, that's green. This looks like it's amber right here. So that's the port that's being blocked. Maybe this port right here, I think it's amber back there. Let's take a look at that. That's amber too, you can see it's blocked right there as well. All right, because now it's not based on the MAC address. Now it's based on the what Cisco calls a bridge ID, which is a combination of the priority number and the MAC address. So if I look at this particular one and I go do show spam, well, no, I'm gonna check that out. All right. Show spanning tree, tab is your friend. Okay, this is now the root bridge. Because the bridge ID, the combination of the priority number and the MAC address, is the lowest across all other switches. Okay, because all the other switches, their priority number is 32.769. Laz, you put zero. Why is that a one? That's a good question. Because this section up here is for the root bridge. This down here is for the switch itself. So here you have the priority that you put, zero, the allowed value, and then you have the system, the VLAN one, which is what exists, and then it added it to that. Okay? So that's why that is one up there. Okay? Because it will add, like if it's, this was VLAN 10, which we haven't created, it would add 10 to 30, you know, to zero, that would be VLAN 10, 20, 30, 30, 40, 40, 40, and so forth. All right, so now this is the root bridge. Awesome. Let's create some VLAN, shall we? All right, config T. VLAN 10, enter. My God, we just created a VLAN. Incredible, incredible. We just created a VLAN. That's awesome. Now we're gonna name it. I get questions last. Can you name a VLAN before you create it? Sure, you could. Why would you? Why would you name something if it doesn't exist? I can see if it's a baby, but it still exists because you know you're having a baby. All right, so you think of a name for the baby. All right, but it's still not, you know, once you write the name of that child on a piece of paper, it's, it doesn't have a name. So the same thing with the VLAN. Create it first, give it life, and then name it, okay? So VLAN 10, name, accounting. VLAN 20, okay? Name, sales. VLAN 30, name, finance. Yeah, we did it. You can't do this in the test, do WR. You gotta go back to privilege mode and do copy, run, start in privilege mode. And then it tells you, hey, do you want it in brackets? Do you want to save it to the startup config file? Enter. Because whatever is in those brackets is default. That's where you're saving it. So you hit enter, enter. All right? Do not click next until you configure everything and make sure everything is working. You're getting the output that Cisco wants. Then you go ahead and click next. All right, so let's check it. Do show VLAN brief. All right, there are VLANs. I'm not assigning them to the core. I'm just creating them in the core. I'm going to make them trickle down to the other switches. Okay, trickle down theory. All right. Then we're going to go ahead and create a VTP domain. I am very surprised that people are turning this off. They're turning off span tree, they're turning off VTP. Unless they have some third-party software to manage their layer 2 infrastructure, they're going to be in a world of hurt later on, okay? So here we're going to do, be very familiar with this particular screen, do show VTP stat, okay? Not too much detail. This number right here, very importante, okay? Very important. The higher the revision number, you have the latest update, all right? And the operating mode of the switch. There's three modes, server, client, and transparent. Server sends, receives information for VLAN database information, so they'll update each other, all right? The server can change, create, and delete VLANs. The client cannot change, delete, or create VLANs. And I mess with the VLAN database. And the last one, transparent, I like to call it the greedy one. What does that do? It doesn't share. It doesn't share its VLAN database. It won't update its database with anybody else's database, and it won't share its database with nobody. So it doesn't share, okay? It doesn't share anything. It will pass the information on through, but it will not share. So the recommendation is one server switch and the rest of the clients. Again, people, I'm gonna remind you throughout this video, it is the CCNA. Hey man, doesn't Laz know that we can create multiple root bridges? Doesn't Laz, yes, Laz knows that, okay? But in the CCNA, you don't need to do that. And that is your goal, that is your objective, okay? Pretend you're playing Halo, this is your primary objective, okay? You need to go to the next level. So the first level, you gotta do it this way, all right? So what we're gonna do is we're gonna create a VTP domain name for security reasons. VTP domain, gotta last. Alright, if you do an up arrow again, do show VTP stat, there's LAS. So now we're all part of LAS domain. It's nothing to do with DNS. Nothing to do with DNS. It's just a name for security purposes that we put there. Alright, so people can say, okay, hey, I'm in the LAS domain. Alright, we're all part of the little LAS neighborhood. That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. Now, you can also put a BTP password, okay? The password will not trickle down, okay, like everything else. All right, you have to do the password manually, and you need to put a password. I don't do it because the packet tracer is the lab, what have you. I want to make it easy. But real world, if you are doing BTP domains, you need to put BTP passwords, because what's the nature of switches? They just forward and forward and forward information, and things just go down. The server will update the clients. So if you plug in your switch, all right, you know, a rogue switch, you'll get that information. You'll join that domain automatically. So you need a password. All right. So we've created the core, we created the VLANs, we did the VTP domain. All right. So now what we're going to do is trunk. What is a trunk? Trunky, if you're just looking at it, you know that these are trunks, these are trunks, these are trunks, these are trunks, and these are trunks. Trunks is where multiple VLANs can go through, and then access, only one VLAN can go through, right? Just a single node can go through there at a time, right? Where through a trunk port, a lot of data can go through at a time. So these trunk ports, we need to give it a type of encapsulation. On a layer 2 switch, all you need to do is switch port mode trunk and it will enable 802.1Q. By default, the ports are dynamic auto. So the ports on the core switch right here, ports 1, 2, and 3, and 24 are the ones that we need to trunk, all right? The only one that's allowed through access ports or trunk ports is the native VLAN. I'm not gonna say VLAN 1, because by default, it's VLAN 1. I'm gonna say the native VLAN, the administrative VLAN, the management VLAN, all right? That is the only one that's allowed to go across. Why? Because in its header, it has something called a PVID, a pivot, port VLAN identifier. So I say, hey man, he's the native VLAN. Let it be, he knows where he's going. Just let him on through, no matter if you're an access port or a trunk port. But all the other VLANs, from 1002 to 1001, they don't know where they're going. So they need to what? Be stamped, they need to be tagged, they need to be frame tagged, right? As they go across these trunk ports and say, hey, you're VLAN 10, you're VLAN 20, you're VLAN 30. This is where you need to go. If you don't do that, they will not go across access ports. You will not be able to communicate with anyone, okay? But everybody within your own little logical broadcast domain. All right, so we're gonna trunk ports 1, 2, 3, and 24. So let's bring this back up here into the recording area. And we're gonna go int range, that's why I did 1, 2, and 3, F0/1-3. And we're gonna do switch ports, tab is your friend, mode trunk, all right? You see everything came up. I'm gonna do int F, I'm gonna put a hyphen. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. You can put a like a little dash, hyphen, whatever it's called. And then put F024, that works. Commas, hyphens, but there's the packet tracer. It's finicky, you know, it works when it wants. Int F0/24. All right, and I'm gonna do the same thing. Switch port mode trunk. Yes, I'm the king of abbreviation. All right, and then I'm gonna do DWR, which you, in the test, are gonna go back to collision mode and do copy run start. All right, so let's verify this information. All right, let's look at our root bridge once again, show spanning tree. And there we are, the root bridge, awesome. Let's do a show VLAN. No, that's nothing. Show VLAN brief, all right, 10, 20, and 30, they're there. Show int, oh no, show VTP stat. Cool, we're last. And then show in trunk now, the trunk ports. And then you're gonna see that 1, 2, and 3 are there. What happened to 24? Well, 24 is pointing to the router. Router's not on, so you won't see it. Once this comes on, then that will show up. All right, so we're ready. All right, and we're gonna come down here. We're gonna verify, because since these ports down here on auto, they're gonna mirror whatever these ports are, so they should be dynamically trunked. So we're gonna go to this switch right here, and I'm gonna leave this like this. hopefully you'll be able to see everything you need to see. Maybe make it a little bit bigger. All right. All right, go here. Enable. Config T. First thing I'm gonna do is change it to a client. So I'm gonna do VTP mode client. Right? And then I'm gonna do show VLAN brief. And that happens. It didn't come down, right? And if you look at this, do show int trunk, you see that that port is, it is trunk, okay? I didn't trunk that port. It did it dynamically because it's dynamic auto. It takes time. It takes time, okay? The packet tracer, it's, you know, it's getting old. So sometimes I have to fast forward through time to help it along. Even sometimes I have to take out the switch or the cable, put a new one in there, and then it'll do it. And sometimes I just reload the switch and I'll do it. So there's a lot of tricks that you may have to do, jump through hoops to make it work. Show int trunk. I mean, show VLAN. Well, first, let's do VTP mode client. I think we did that already, but just in case, VTP mode client, can't hurt. All right, and then see, it's already a client. All right, okay. Then I'm gonna do show VLAN brief. Hey, and there they are. See, it takes time. So this switch that we're on, the 10 network, it's gonna be the accounting switch. So I'm gonna give it that name, host name, host up, no, tab, that's why I tab. Host name, ACCT, why am I in caps, ACCT. All right, so now this is the accounting switch. So we're gonna go ahead and assign this VLAN to a particular range. So we're gonna go int VLAN, int range F0/1-15. That's not what I do. Alright, and then I go switch port mode access because you're assigning VLAN. They must be access ports. And then I go switch port access VLAN what? 10. Awesome. Alright. But while I'm here, these are access ports. Span tree doesn't need to be looking at access port. So I'm gonna do spanning tree, not SAP, spanning tree, port fast, turn that thing off. But then obviously somebody didn't get the memo and they're gonna go ahead and see that warning. Somebody's gonna plug in an internet networking device and then create a broadcast over my network, and then I'm gonna have to get, you know, rough and not like doing that. So I'm gonna do spanning tree, BPDU guard enable, right? So it does, guard there, sentry, that's looking for bridge protocol data units and says no bridge protocol data units are allowed on this port, or I will shut it down and put it in an ERR disabled state. Okay, so now that's based on efficiency, that error, efficiency. So what we're gonna do is switch, also we're gonna do some little bit of security, switch port, port, not pole, not hydraulic pole, port security. And I'm going to up arrow and I'm going to do something called max sticking. Switches learn source addresses dynamically and place them in the MAC address table dynamically. Well, when you do the sticking command, it will learn it dynamically but place it in the MAC table as static. Like if you actually load it by yourself. So it's there forever and a day. All right, so I'm going to up arrow again, get rid of MAC, put max, and I'm going to put 1 because I'm just that type of ruthless leader. I don't believe in BYOD, bring your own device. No, you work with a device that I give you on my network. You do not bring your own laptop from home and your kid's laptop or whoever's laptop and plug your stuff in. Not allowed, not happening. All right, so go up here for security and I'm gonna do VIO, shut. All right, and that's what Cisco wants. Shut down the freaking port. Not restrict, not protect. We won't allow the packets into the network. One creates a log, the other one doesn't, and it will increment the VTP. No, shut it down, right? If a port, if you violated something, if you're not using it, shut that port down, okay? So now you're done. DWR, control Z, that's verify showing. Always verify, show VLAN, brief. And there we have access VLAN 10, accounting on all these ports right here. If you do a showing trunk, you saw that already earlier. Showing trunk, you see that it is trunk already, automatically, because that's the mode of the port, auto. All right, and then we're gonna do show VTV, stat. There you see we're all LAS. We're part of the LAS domain, that's right. Okay, so that's just the way it is. Okay, that's the way you configure this. There's a lot more to it. Again, this is just episode one. Okay, there's a lot more to it, and we will be doing it. So let's go to the next switch. The next piece of the switch. Okay, bring it over here. And I think it's been long enough. Now we're not gonna have to do that. All right, enable config T, BTP mode, client, then do show BTP stat. And it's a client. Oh, see me. Yes, there's the client. Do show VLAN brief. And there they are. So there's a sales VLAN. So I'm going to go in range. It's redundant, isn't it? In range, F0/1. That's what we have automation now. 15. And then with the switch port mode access. And then we do switch port access VLAN 20. Yeah. Okay, now we're gonna turn off span tree on these particular ports. Using the port fast command, we're gonna guard against it. Span tree, VPDU guard enable. And then we're gonna do some basic security. Switch port hyphen security, that turns it on. Port security, Mac sticky, not Mac, they got Mac. All right, Mac Davis, you remember Mac Davis? Mac, sticky, sorry. Mac sticky, and then up arrow, we'll do a maximum of 1. And it's whatever they tell you, obviously, when you go take the CCNA, they'll tell you what they want, so you can figure what they want. And then we put VIO, short for violation. All right, shut. All right, so done there. Same thing we did in the last switch. And then we can go ahead and verify. There, control Z to quickly take me to privilege mode. So I do my show, my VLAN brief. And remember, you can pause this video at any time. All right. Take a look at it. All right. There. Show VLAN brief. Show VTP stat. Client. Here I am. LAS. Show int trunk. There's a ports that are trunk. Lovely. All right. So we're done here. All right. For now. For this first episode. For now. All right. Do the same thing over here. CLI, do enable, config T, VTP mode client, and then do show VLAN brief. Aha, there's 30. So again, int range F01-15, switch port mode access, switch port access VLAN 30. All right, and we do spanning tree port fast, spanning tree VPD guard enable, switch port hyphen security, up arrow, Mac sticky. All right, up arrow, maximum of 1, and then up arrow, VIO shut. All right, there we are. Awesome, and I'm not gonna verify that. Because we know we're good, but let's just look at them right now. Show me that brief. There they are, right there. All right, cool. So now we're all in our own VLANs. All right, I'm gonna fast forward through time. I'm making this a habit now from now on. It's to do fast forwarding through time because, yeah, it's all crazy. So now they're in their own VLANs, but they can't communicate with nobody because they're in their own broadcast domain. You've increased the number of broadcast domains, which is good. Because you've decreased the number of the amount of broadcasts that exist on your network. So VLANing your network, it is crucial. So now we're gonna go to the router. Alright, and we have multiple VLANs. But we only have what's called a router on a stick. Okay? And I don't need to look at these PCs. So we're gonna do CLI, we're gonna say no. Then we're going to enable fake team. I get this guy a host name. Let me just R1, all right, make it simple. And under the interface, which is G00, if I'm not mistaken, let me go down. Yep, G00. Get back here so you can see it. All right, under G00, I am not going to put an IP address over there. I'm just going to turn it on. No shot. All right, so that turns it on. So now I'm going to create virtual interfaces. So I'm going to go up arrow, G00. I'm going to do the first one for VLAN 1, all right, which is not there. We haven't done it. Okay, so for VLAN 1, the next step you must do before you put the default gateway. So we must encap, short for encapsulation, is the .1.2. This number that you're about to put, that number must match the VLAN ID, which is 1. The interface that I created, the sub-interface, you can put whatever number, you know, to your heart's desire. But if it's for VLAN 1, why would you put 3 or 80 or, you know, whatever? If it's for VLAN 1, put 1. Visualization, okay? And then, but here, for .1.2, it must match the VLAN ID. And then we go ahead and do a scheme for VLAN 1. So we're going to say IP address 192.168.1.1.255.255.255.0. Oh, I'm sorry. Let me back that up. 254. I use the last available IP address for the gateway. So that would be 254. Then 255.255.255.0. Enter. And you don't need to no shut it. It's the physical interface. So all I do now is just up arrow. Interface 10. We have to do VLAN 10 next. All right. Enter. NCAP 10. Gateway. Arrow my way down over here. Put a 0 right there. That's my gateway. Enter. Lovely. So I'm going with 10. That's 20. Up arrow. Sub interface 20. Enter. Okay. And then we're going to do NCAP 20. All right, and then the default gateway, arrow, 20. Okay, and then we'll do the last one, which is 30. Sub interface 30. NCAP 30. Because that's the VLAN ID. And then the gateway, right there. Just change that to a 30. Good to go. Cool. Now we're going to do a WR, or for you guys, copy run start. Control Z. I'm going to look. I'm going to verify. Show up your route. I say, oh, look, I'm connected to 10, to 30. All right. I don't see 20. Do you see 20 somewhere? Here's 1. Here's 10, 10, 10, 30, 30. What happened to 20? All right, let's take a look. Show IP and brief. And did anyone do 20? Oh, and 20, I put 30. You see? That's why we must verify. So what do we need to do? Good. I'm glad this happened. Because if we don't verify, we're going fast, we can make a mistake. Int G0/0.20. So I'm now in that interface. I can overwrite the IP address because you only have one IP address. So IP address 192.168.20. Oops. 254, 255.255.255.0, DWR, right? Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to stay in that with sub-interface because I have a sneaky suspicion. You show start. There's VLAN 1, that one Q1. You can see this communicating with the native VLAN. So it should be 1, 1, 1, 10, 10, 10. You see I've created sub-interface 20. I'll do the .1Q, 30. That will be a problem. You will not be able to communicate. So, since I'm in some interface, I will do no NCAP .1Q, it's 20, it's 30, that point right there. And do NCAP .1Q 20. Do WR. Now, let's verify that. Show start. Align my line. Native, good, 10, 10, 10, 20. She has no IP address because you have to put in the encapsulation, then you need to put the default gateway, so remember that. And we have no 30. All right, so Let's go ahead and do config t, conf t, which is good. We got a little troubleshooting in there. Int g0 slash 0.20. And then we'll do IP address 192.168.20.24. 255.255.255.0. Enter. So now let's do 30. So the first thing we'll do is sub interface 30. Ncap. Oh, ncap 30. And then default gateway 30. All right, I'm gonna do WR. Packet trace is a little funny. So I'm also gonna do what you need to do, which is copy. Start, enter, enter. All right, and now we're going to do a show IP and greet. There we go. There's our VLAN 1, 10, 20, and 30. 1, 10, 20, and 30. Proper gateways. There's another one you can use. It's called show protocols. Because it's the same thing as show IP and greet, but now you can see the actual masks, which we're all using 24, which is nice. It does up, down, 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 straight down, whatever the case. Then we do a show start. So we can match up everything, make sure that everything's correct. So here we have, I'm hitting enter. 1, 1, 1, okay. See, native, I didn't tell it that, it knows, it's communicating. 10, 10, 10, 20, 20, 20. This is why I do what I do, 30, 30, 30. So it can make sense, all right? You can verify very easily. You're learning a concept, you need to be memorizing a bunch of other stuff. So you should be able to ping. The only one that has an IP address is this guy. So we're gonna go here, we're gonna ping one, well, let's do an IP config first, right? I know there's 30.24, but you know, how would you really do it, right? So you know, IP config, oh, not IPO, that's something different. IP config, all right, there's your gateway. So ping 192.168.30.24, voila. Let's see if we can ping 20.24. Well, no, you can't ping. Oh, you can, because that's a router. 20.24. You can. All right. So then 10.24. So we actually have connectivity to all the other PCs' gateways. So let's run down what we did. We went ahead and connected all those together, obviously. We made this guy. I'm going to call him here so you can see him as the core. Okay. We made this guy the root bridge. Everybody else is non-root bridges, all right? And this port is blocked, this port is blocked, so we can prevent from switching from happening. We created a BTP domain name last. We trunked these particular ports, all right? So the information can flow out to the router, all right? And they can communicate with each other if they want to, all right? And you may think, hey, that's defeating the purpose. No, that's why we have the command allow VLANs. And we also can use access list to block where we need to block. And then once we did the trunking, we did the VLANs, we did the BTP, we did the spanning tree, okay? And then here, these are all became client operating mode, right? So these are all client switches. And then the VLANs came down. It took a while, right? We had to fast forward. I had to do a couple little tricks there. Waited a little bit, and we saw how they trickled down. And then assigned the appropriate VLAN per ports using the range command. And once we assign the VLANs and turn them into access mode, that's the whole trick too, because switch port security cannot be enabled in dynamic auto. It'll give you an error. It must be in access mode. So we went ahead and did assign the VLANs, or was it already created on the core? So we assigned the VLANs. We turned off span tree on the access ports where the end devices are, because there's no BBDs there. Put a guard there, BPU guard, just in case, you know, somebody didn't get the memo and plugged in a switch and a port they shouldn't have. So it'll prevent switching loops. All right, it'll shut down that port. And we also have switch port security turned on. And we really didn't look at that, but, I want to maximize it because we go outside the recording area. We don't want that. And then we'll do here, enable, show MAC address table. You can see that F01 shows up as static. Shows up as that, okay? So that's one of the things. Now, we don't have an IP address on here. This guy was pinging his life away. So let's go to this switch right here. All right, we're gonna do enable, show MAC address table. All right, again, here's static, all right? Here's where port security is working. And then we do show port hyphen security. And you're gonna see that F01 has an actual count of one because it learned the first IP address or learned the first MAC address of that particular PC. And there hasn't been any violations, but if there is, it's gonna shut it down. So that's how you would look at it, doing the show port security. But you can see, like I told you, it puts it in as static. That's why we need that. And if somebody violates that, it will be the same error, ERR disabled. So, we come to the end of episode one. In the next episode, we'll go ahead and start doing the ACP and a lot more things. See you then.